Thank you, Aaron. Thanks, everybody, for joining me today. So what I'm going to talk about in a rapid-fire 20-minute whiteboard format is how you can actually build out automation at scale. And this is based on my personal experiences. And I first got involved in automation really early on. I gave talks at Black Hat, I think about 7 years ago, on cloud security automation, and kind of have been moving up the stack from there. And what I'm going to describe is kind of the journey that I took in automation in terms of how we actually ended up building getting to some particular architectures. And the advantage of this is that it'll show you the path that I took, that the people I work with took, but it will also give you a sense of, you know, what might be the best option for you, because the paths that I took might not always be the exact paths that you want to take. And we're going to do this a little bit differently. I'm doing everything kind of as a live whiteboarding exercise. So basically, here's the core problem. Almost all organizations who want to do automation, we start with some basic Lambda functions, or maybe you run something on your desktop or in a container. Maybe it's something you wrote yourself. Maybe it's an open source tool. Maybe you're out there using Cloud Mapper or Prowler or a bunch of the other tools that we have available to us these days. But yet when it comes down to it, the real challenge isn't running an automation. It's basically, how do you actually go ahead and scale that up? So if we look at, you know, the options here, almost everybody has some kind of a SecOps account, security operations account, incident response account, something along those lines. And we need to be able to go into all of the different target accounts that we're responsible for managing the security of. It doesn't matter if this is for incident response. It doesn't matter if this is for assessment, cloud security posture management, whatever it is, we have to get into those. And by the way, I'm going to go ahead and use predominantly AWS terminology to make my life a whole lot easier. I actually have built some of this for both AWS and for Azure, or at least my team has. I have not done it for Google yet, but the principles are all the same. But for simplicity's sake, I'm going to use AWS terms so I don't have to say account/subscription, because that gets awkward. All right, so we need to go into all of the accounts. We also need to go into all of the regions of the accounts and the geographical distributions. So this is a challenge when we need to do this at scale, because some of us have to deal with handling this on hundreds or thousands of accounts. And if you're on the vendor side, you've got to deal with it for tens of thousands or more different accounts, never mind the proliferation of all the additional regions on top of it as well. So what are some of the options here? Well, the most basic option where I kind of started was, so here's how I started. I did automation, kind of isolated, single account, just kind of doing my own thing. Then I would kind of build up a list to have it target a couple of accounts using IAM cross-account access. And I'll go into some of the details of some of the specific IAM challenges in a moment. So the first version of this, super simple, just single instance or container. I was running instances at the time because containers didn't exist really in a meaningful way when I started this. I mean, they did, but they didn't. And then it would go ahead and target the individual accounts. It would also have to deal with managing all the different regions in the accounts. Well, that's fine, but it's really not efficient. Hit service limits. It takes forever to run these assessments. If you're running code out of a single platform, timing, everything is just not great. We did it to kind of learn how to do it. The next step was to move into leveraging autoscale groups. And doing this early on, I decided not just a fleet that would actually divvy out and attack all of the different accounts, but a fleet of workers that would be able to do so in more of a pull-oriented way. So basically, you've got the worker node sitting in there. There would be some kind of command and control structure up here. It could just be as simple as a schedule that would run on a schedule. It would put messages onto SQS, and then in the autoscale group, the worker nodes would pull. So they would pull the messages out of SQS, it would get its assignment, and then it would target its target account for what it needed to do. This really introduced a lot of efficiency, especially introduced a lot of efficiency when we moved off of instances and into a container infrastructure. And again, as a reminder, when I first started building this, ECS didn't exist, Kubernetes was really early, so it was hard to actually do this in a containerized way. So instead, that's why we did initially instances, then we were able to migrate that code pretty seamlessly into containers at that point. The key trick that we had was making sure that we could those workers would kill themselves off when they were done, because Boto has memory leaks was a big part of it, and a bunch of this code was running in Boto at the time. So that was kind of the architectural approach that we took that was more efficient. Now, in terms of you, in terms of what you are doing, in particular, if you're going to run the off-the-shelf open source tools, and if they haven't been built for serverless, I still think that this is a very, very viable option for you to go ahead and use. It's a great place to start. In using a queue or some kind of a scheduling function can really make it a lot easier, because once you get to pull, you get just get all of these efficiencies. We actually had a subsystem that was running purely on a schedule, and we were running into a bunch of issues with long-running containers, which shouldn't have been there, but it was a basically, let's be honest, it was a developer, philosophical mistake from a developer. When we moved to SQS, pull, do its job, shut down, all the memory leaks went away, and everything became much, much happier for us. So, but this isn't the only option. So another option is distributed instances and containers. I've seen people do this like with Cloud Custodian. So you have central command and control. That's my feeble attempt to type right in CNC. And what you really have is in each of these environments, you have containers or instances. Typically these days, again, it's more likely to be containers, but you could still use instances that actually have all of the running code. So instead of running it centrally, you're actually running it in the local account. Now, one of the main reasons to do this is typically going to be because of IAM concerns, for example. Because in the earlier model that I had here, you obviously need centralized IAM roles that can do a lot in each of these individual environments. But if I switch to running the containers in each account in each region, then they only need localized permissions, and you don't have to worry about things breaking out as much. Now, it's not a panacea, because the command and control is still centralized, and depending on the level of permissions these things have, could the command and control itself could do all sorts of badness. So the command and control is what connects in, and it can either send commands out, and it can go ahead and pull reports or results back for dashboarding and for whatever else you want. Another option here is then this, you could actually also enable a local view. So there's a little bit more complexity, because the system that you're using has to be able to support this centralized dashboarding. And there's a bunch of different ways. You could just move JSON results or whatever else that you want around in order to get that. But however, it definitely does have some of the down, you know, a mix of those upsides and the downsides. And so in terms of these central management options, what could you actually build out? Well, there's a few different things that make sense at this point. So you could go fully serverless. And a way of doing that is imagine if those local things saved to a central S3 bucket, and then that would trigger serverless that would pull those results and move them into a central area. Again, there's a lot of different ways to do this. I never personally had to build this particular architecture, so I don't have a lot of hard lessons learned on it. But I've talked with a bunch of people who have. The other is you know, maybe you just enable central reporting, and that would be, you know, similar to what I just described. So serverless could be back and forth. Central reporting means you're just pulling those results out. And it could also just be a container. And some of these tools will actually allow you to centralize results and kind of view, allow you to basically have some additional level of centralized control around there. So the pros of this are you do get your local control, and that would allow differences and variations between teams and environment, and you're still able to maintain what I'm going to call code reuse, which means that you're not building everything from scratch in each environment. Those of you who are doing like a lot of Lambda functions and config, if you're not encoding that, that's obviously another option. Into CloudFormation templates or Terraform, you're having to rebuild a lot of this code around there, and you have to tune it for different environments. So again, this centralized option handles this. Now, the problem is overall code maintenance, because anytime you're dealing with a lot of code being distributed in a lot of different places, that gets really complex. You've got to deal with, change management is going to be a big part of it. That's my little attempt at a delta. Just overall maintenance for this is definitely going to be higher. Now, do you want to take a step back? There's an option I didn't talk about because especially it just wasn't even viable until relatively recently, which is using only native tools. So using config or in Azure, using some of their capabilities through the security center and then Lambda functions for remediations. That's really hard to scale right now still. There's, again, you can get a pretty decent way with it. We know, I've heard that Netflix and some others are starting to move a lot more towards that kind of an environment. And if you've got the ability to handle that through your CI/CD pipeline and make sure that your infrastructure is code and your landing zones and that stuff is all really well refined, that is a viable option. Obviously, in that case, everything is relatively distributed and we have more centralization capabilities, but this gets really into the specifics of each provider and how to pull it off. So I'm not going to spend really any time on that. So moving on to the next option, this is moving away from instances and containers and moving more into serverless. So what you have is in your SecOps account, you're going to go ahead and build your serverless architecture centrally. Then you're going to have in your distributed environments the ability to run in parallel across all of the accounts and the regions inside your target accounts. Now there's different ways of doing this, obviously. So I'm going to describe the approach that I've taken. So in the centralized serverless, basically there's a couple of boxes that break out here. There is based something, I'm going to call it the controller. So the controller function is, it actually can start time-based. Our early versions of this, we're actually running out of containers. This is what manages the jobs and everything else that needs to occur into the environment. And then it will go ahead, send those instructions out, and then typically drop them onto an SQS queue. Then the SQS queue, and to make this work right, it's going to have a job ID associated with it. That SQS spawns parallel running across every account and region that's there because it's just spun up a bunch of Lambda functions. One Lambda function per region, per account is the way to go ahead and actually run this completely in parallel. But because those are all tagged with the job IDs, then the results come back and they can either drop into another queue here, or you can go ahead and write them directly to a database. In this case, it's was in Dynamo. So the results get stored into the database there. So the idea being that you've got some level of a controller function, then that's going to go ahead and trigger the jobs. Those goes into the queue. SQS ties with the serverless side with Lambda. I actually recently did some experiments and did a version of this on Azure as well, natively running in Azure, not running in Amazon and connecting to Azure, which is how I'd previously handled Azure stuff before. Then everything runs in parallel across all of those environments. All the results get spewed back centrally, and then you're good to go. Now that I described in language in terms of just assessment, I'm going to get into the fact that you can do the exact same thing for remediation. And on the remediation side, it's the same thing. You're going to drop the message into the queue, and then centrally, it's going to make the changes into those environments. We'll talk about some of the IAM stuff that gets involved in there. But this is the big thing, because the big area where you actually will run into issues around this is the big bad on all of it is IAM, and then the other one is going to be service limits. These are the two things that challenge this approach. Also, you're going to have more complexity because now you've got to be able to maintain a lot of this stuff in parallel. And to be honest, one of the biggest blockers we actually run into is the org chart, where security isn't allowed to gain the right access into those environments to get their jobs done. And that is a combination of a political issue and a technical issue, because there are some technical things you can do to go ahead and reduce the impact on that. So let's look at how you manage some of these kinds of blockers. Now, the one for IAM to the approach that I took was basically think about all the permissions this needs to have. And it's going to be different, ideally, on a per account basis, because in production environments, you're probably going to want different sets of what this automation can do in terms of read and write access. In development environments, you have to maintain your permissions. And here's another complexity. If you're using least permissions, and then you add like a new kind of an assessment. So Access Analyzer comes out, and you want to be able to touch those results, and it's a new API endpoint that you didn't have permission to. It's a new permission. How do you actually go ahead and update all of that? Well, here's the way the approach that that we took. So we broke up into two roles. So there's a provisioner role and there's a worker role. And as you can imagine, the worker role is the one that does everything in the individual accounts. And within each individual account, there's cross-account access for both the provisioner and the worker. Then we have these things connected only, these actually in my case run in separate accounts. They're only connected using SQS. And so the provisioner and the worker are permission boundary locked so that they can't, the provisioner can change the rights of the worker, but not its own rights. The worker can do what it needs to, but it can never change its own permissions or that of the provisioner. So there's locks in place to manage all of this. And so the provisioner can go into the account, make changes so that the worker can go ahead and actually do more or less or what it needs to do. This is how you can push updates out at scale, because the provisioner can go through and make all of the changes to all the accounts, 100 accounts as needed across all the workers. You can do it in a pretty secure fashion, especially because the provisioner needs escalated privileges for it to work. And so what makes this work is the permission boundaries and I'm not spelling correctly, so I'll just leave it at that. The security around this, making sure they're locked to each other, making sure those accounts are segregated from each other. There's always going to be some level of risk. You can't fully handle that, but that can reduce it. Now, the other big problem that I mentioned is going to be service limits. And so running into service limits, and this is, you know, the problem in every single environment you go into, basically is in particular when you do assessments versus changes, because you don't typically do write changes at scale. Where you're going to run into service limits. But if you want to do like an assessment of an environment, look at all the security groups, look at all the IAM roles, you're going to hit limits. And so the way we handled that was with a fleet of either containers or serverless that will go ahead and hit up and do their assessments on those environments like once an hour. And then that all gets stored. And in our case, it's an Elasticsearch database. And then that connects in to GraphQL. And so the model for this is GraphQL queries allows you to query to do your assessments off of the Elasticsearch database, however, without having to hit the account with a describe call every time. Brings in efficiencies. There's lots of tools out there that do versions of this. There's tools like Antiope that will actually help you maintain an inventory. There's other ones whose names I'm forgetting as I'm talking quickly that will be able to link into kind of link into all of those environments. Now, you can do this on a schedule basis, or you can actually trigger it so that these things will only do a reassessment anytime, basically by being event-based. So I'm going to show the event-based architecture here in a moment, but anytime that there's a write change to the environment, that can trigger a reassessment right at that time. So that can be a bit more efficient. You still want to sweep through probably once an hour, but that means that you should be up to date on all of the changes in near real time, as opposed to having to just wait for a schedule. Now, the next is when we started getting fancy. And here, there's a couple of things, basically different ways that we can trigger. So in the central of this is something like a Kinesis pipeline, or it could be Kafka or whatever else basically in your environment. We're moving to an event-driven architecture at this point. And changes can come in via like CloudWatch events or a schedule or API calls. And then any of these things, and there's a receiver that basically sends it, can go into this Kinesis pipeline. And then from the Kinesis pipeline, it can trigger either an assessment or it can trigger an action. And moving to this starts giving you a lot of really cool advantages. Aside from the scaling, it also enables a fully event-driven architecture for cloud detection and response, because you can detect a change in your environment and then run that through a rules engine. And then that rules engine can go ahead and trigger an action. And then you use Dynamo database on the back end or whatever relational database you want, I don't really care, to keep all of the results and the state of what's going on at any given point in time. And this works. It's not fantasy. We've got it up and running and built where the events come in, gets assessed, triggers world actions. If you want to see a very early, or not an early, a different model for this, more along the sim lines, go ahead and take a look at like Stream Alert, which is a fully serverless event-driven architecture for pulling events out of different environments and then running rules and then doing, you could, in that case, it goes to alerts, but you could obviously link that up to Lambda functions or something to go ahead and take actions in your environment. So now we get to fully serverless, fully event-driven. This is, I think, the real sweet spot once you have to go to very, very large scale, because you end up with a very responsive system. You can do really cool things right away. Like if you get a guard duty alert for a cryptocurrency miner, you can pretty much immediately shut it down and stop it. If you have weird IAM changes, you can trigger, because the rules engines can be flexible, so you can trigger it out to just do a Slack notification or something along those lines. So that's it. I think I'm probably 30 seconds over on my time. I've never done this talk this quickly before, so hopefully it went well, and I'll turn it over for questions. And if you have any other questions, that's out of it. Rumor is I'm pretty easy to track down.
Thanks, Rich. I will say the whiteboard session went over really well, and I hope I'm not sharing any secrets by saying that while those of us in the control room were terrified of the path from iPad over AirPlay over Stream, it worked great. So well done, and I know there are some people in the Slack who want pointers. But about the contents of your talk, which I think is probably more important, number one question was, if these rules are running in the account, how does the central provisioner detect or detect or respond to cases where the account owner themselves might be messing with them to send you wrong or incorrect data?
Yeah, so the non-repudiation part of this and making sure only the authorized things does get a little bit more complicated. You got to be really, really strict around that central account, the rules. The other thing is, in particular, like, we've architected for multi-tenancy. So there's, nonces and account ID things that tokens basically that have to be passed through. There's other things I didn't get into, like using different external IDs and stuff and heavy tracking. But another one is have two versions that are constantly checking each other as well. So, it's serverless. I mean, you just, and that gives you a failover as well at that point. So having one account that can, or even just another region in the main account, but ideally another account. So having the two accounts balance each other is a way to approach that as well.
Cool. Questions on some other AWS tools that might have helped or hurt here. Mm-hmm. So one is, if you've looked from Alexander, have you looked into step functions, which would allow for retries and post-processing of findings in structured workflows?
Yeah, so part of it, the early days step functions I played with, they weren't mature enough. The step functions can help a lot if you're fully building from scratch, but the level of I would say that those would work really well at the start, and you can probably get a lot of legroom out of that. They just weren't intelligent enough. There were just the limitations for the kind of smarts we needed into the system. So that's why we keep going back for layers is another, piece that another one that we play with. And I know that prototyped a lot of stuff, but we have I've got developers who do a bunch of this stuff now as well. And they played with some of those. We haven't gotten it to the point where it's got the intelligence to take over from the, what we call a task manager, which actually manages that internally. And once you go to fully event driven, then some of the step function stuff starts to go away because it's everything is an event. So trigger an assessment, getting a result, a proper action. Like if everything is an event, that changes architecturally how you approach it.
A question from Ricardo is, what are your views on how AWS configs custom rules could be improved to support event-based assessments like this?
I think they're moving down that road. I suppose if I say price, they've got a little bit cheaper, but it's still not exactly what everybody wants. The biggest thing is being able to run effectively centralized. And yeah, absolutely. I mean, at some point in time, Amazon could make that a bit more, more robust, and they're constantly improving that. Some of the bigger issues now, though, is config is it's being able to get all the sensors and get everything wired up correctly. There's just levels of complexity for the build your own there. I think that if Amazon simplifies that, it could really do most of what I described today, or very large portions of that.
Cool. And then one final question, which is, when you're using these bulk micro rules and orchestrating a bunch of rules like this, how do you debug, right? I heard some things about job IDs. I heard some things are central, but how do you track what is and isn't working when you're in this massive distributed serverless design?
We keep adding layers and layers of instrumentation until something breaks that we didn't see. And then we have to go ahead and add more instrumentation. So there's it is really hard to get the right visibility in the serverless. Obviously, there's a range of in frequently in large part commercial tools that are available, as well as some of the stuff that's built, you know, X-ray and stuff. But yeah, it can be really hard. As long as the biggest thing to do is be good about tracking state. Making sure that you have the ability to kind of track these IDs and these jobs and these events and have reproducible. But I'll be honest, of everything I talked about, that is one of the biggest challenges, is to kind of keep that visibility in the environment and do that debugging. And especially because, like, there's really weird stuff you'll run into. So I have my original Amazon account, which is over 10 years old at this point. Or is it over? I don't know. I can't remember what year I started, early in the EC2 days, and it started breaking lots of our stuff, lots of automation as building it out early, because, and it makes a great test account. Things like finding elastic network interfaces that weren't associated with anything, not with any instances or anything else. Or then you'll hit that one account that still has some VPC Classic or something like that in there. So those tend to be the tougher issues, is no matter how much you try, once you start scaling, you're not going to be correct about, you know, kind of all of your assumptions. This is why, as well, you absolutely want to run everything in a read-only mode before you turn on the actual make repairs. Or some of the stuff that we've done is put a human in the loop. So it's read-only, generates an event, goes to a Slack message to somebody so they can make the decision about when that action executes. And you do that for a while and you get your environments tuned, and then you can go on to the full read-write automation. But, you know, it gives you a kind of a blended way to do all of that.
Oh, awesome. Thank you so much. I'd ask everyone to leave feedback at bit.ly/FWDCS-5 or in the Slack. And we're going to take a 30-minute break. We'll come back after lunch Eastern time at 1:30 with the attack and defense session. James Condon will kick it off with a look at threat actors targeting the cloud and their battle for superiority. Should be great. I'll see you in about 30 minutes. Thank you so much, Rich.
Thank you.